Love is the secret. Love is the key. Love is an emotion that's of like the highest vibration. Do you know how you feel when you feel loved?
Yeah.
Having that feeling behind a vision is what brings it to life.
Much for taking the time to stop on this video. Women of Tomorrow is a platform dedicated to the success and longevity of women. So if that's you, please take a moment and watch this video. Comment, like, share, and subscribe.
Hi!
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I am pretty shook though.
What?
I'm shook. I'm shook.
Why is that?
Well, I'm so happy.
Yes.
I'm really happy. And I feel like I'm honored. I've been following you for a few years now.
Oh.
I know. And I'm so... like, you're the epitome of, like, I'm growing up, I did not have any type of, like, I didn't have any idols or crushes or anything. I was just not that girl.
Yeah.
But what I can say as I've grown into a woman, it's just, like, I can pinpoint some women who I'm, like, I really admire.
Yeah.
How you live your life. It, you know, what I've seen of it.
Yeah.
And the message that you portray. Yeah. You know, with what you put out there. And so it's just like kind of like a blueprint for mm-hmm. me. It's like I'm always like you're on the mood board type
yeah.
vibe.
Oh, my gosh.
I love everything that I just love how it's all come together for you.
Yeah.
And I'm inspired by it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And I'm honored as well just to be here and just to hear those things that you just said about me. Like that actually inspires me to like keep going
keep
and to
going.
Keep. Yes. 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 So. Thank you for having me here today.
And so I noticed that you don't do a lot of interviews.
No, I don't. I've only like started doing them recently. Like okay. I've never just like talked. Like that's never been me. But yeah.
And so you're doing them more. Is it because of the new, is it Love Harvest?
Love's Harvest, Love's my Harvest. Cannabis dispensary. Yes. That's partly why, but the bigger picture of it was like, I was low key in like retirement mode on my farm, living my best life. And I had like this epiphany and it was just like, you're not done yet. Like, I need you to go back outside for a bit. So,
wow.
Yes. And so that's why I'm here now. It's really just like, I've learned so many things like throughout my journey. And it's like, my goal is just to share all of that with everyone. So, that's why I'm talking now.
Yes, talk. I mean, I watch your YouTubes and stuff like that, but I'm just so honored to be like here. I've made it, you know.
Yes.
So I want to like I have so many questions. Like we literally like put together like 300 questions, but we won't have time for that.
It's all good.
But I love to start with just like where are you from mm-hmm. and how did you grow up? Like okay. What are your memories of childhood?
Yeah. So I'm originally from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. I was born and raised there. But during the summers, I spent my summers, every summer as a child in Mississippi on my great grandmother's property. Mm. So it would be myself, my younger brother, and like tons of cousins just like running around barefoot.
Wow.
Playing in the mud, feet going and picking berries off the trees.
Wow.
And so, yeah. So that was like what my summers were like. And then, I grew up in like a upper middle class. My parents were super strict.
They were?
Oh my gosh.
Like, what
beyond.
Do you mean strict? Like no friends, no parties, no.
Oh, definitely no parties. I could have friends, but like I hardly, was able to go to like a basketball game or a football game or anything like that without them being there.
Mm.
Like it was really strict. And it was because my parents had me at a very young age. So it was
okay.
like, yeah, we don't want that to happen to you. So we're going to like put you in handcuffs.
What do you think about that? Like the children that are like so sheltered.
Yeah.
Did you like rebel at any point?
Actually, I did not. And I was like, I felt like another kid in my position probably would have,
yeah.
you know. But I rebelled a little bit, but I didn't go like way left field.
You didn't go crazy. You know?
No, I did it. I did it. It was just more so of like, I'm free now.
Well,
like,
what age was that when you felt free?
It probably wasn't until I was like went to school, like college. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
But you actually, so that's why I said like I really didn't like really just rebel or anything. So
they had you at a young age, and they were strict. Now, was that like religious? Was that like religion involved with that?
Oh yes. So well, not so much my dad, but my mom. Like she grew up in like the Baptist church. Like we're from down south, so that is the thing. Going to church every Sunday. That's not that's like a non-negotiable. Okay. Like you had to do that. But like at the age of 13, I told my mom, like, I don't believe in this anymore. Like this just doesn't feel good to me. Like I'm not going anymore. And that kind of like, that didn't sit too well.
It didn't sit well.
Yeah.
I wish I had done that because from a very little girl, like I grew up in the church. We were Seventh-day Adventists. Oh, it was mostly my dad who was like strict. And my mom, you know, she was along for the ride. And then, but we had to go to Sabbath school. Sabbath school is like Sunday school, but it's just like on Saturday, you know.
Yeah.
And I just didn't. And then back then it was just so much about, it was like fear mongering. Yes. It was like, there's, what's going on?
Yes.
Like, what are we doing? Like, yes. I'm scared.
Exactly. It didn't feel good. It's like every time I remember going to church, it was like they were putting down the young kids and the kids these days and it's like I don't want to hear this. Like y'all are like I come in here, I sit down, you guys are like tearing us down. Like this doesn't feel good.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, I was like, I'm done with that.
And so by 13 you had like the confidence to be like, Mom.
Oh yes, like I'm done with this. Yeah.
And what did she say?
Oh gosh. She was like, no ma'am, that's not happening. I'm like, no ma'am, you're not listening to me. I'm not doing this anymore. And actually I don't think I ever went to church again.
Never
after
again.
That.
And have you ever been again, even as an adult?
No.
How do you feel about church now? It's just like, it's not for you.
It's not for me. It's not for me. I'm more like spiritual in a sense. Okay. Like it's not for me.
So our spiritual, I mean, I'm very spiritual as well. And I feel like for me, the spiritual journey is one where you're like getting to know yourself.
Oh my gosh. Self-mastery. Mm-hmm. I have been talking about this like all day, but that's what it is. Like we are spirit at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. So it's all about self-discovery, exploring ourselves and getting to know ourselves. Yes.
Yes. And people often say that that's selfish or blasphemous or like that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But
no, it's not, because at the end of the day, that is what allows us to be these amazing human beings that we are. Mm. You know, I feel like I'm not going to say that just the church systems, but there's so much programming that happens that that strips us of that. And I feel like that's our identity, magic. That's our power, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I love it. I love it. So you said around the time when you went to school, college.
Yeah.
That's when you felt your most free. Like you were like, no one's around every day looking over my shoulder.
Yes.
And so you went to school for medicine?
Yes. I actually went to LSU for pre-med. Yes. I did 2 years. But like my senior year of high school, I was already taking like college courses. And so I went to summer school, took courses, and I did like 2 years. But then I like dropped out.
And so you were really interested in medicine at that point.
Oh,
when you
yes. Because I've always like felt like I was like a healer, like a medicine woman almost, you know, and always wanted to help people. So I felt like that was like the path, you know.
Wait, so tell me this. How did you feel like you were a healer? Like, because this was obviously as a young age, right?
Always.
Were you like healing people at a young age or what were you doing? Like, what was it?
Not necessarily. It was just something that I felt within myself. You know what I'm saying? Like people always came to me for help.
Okay.
Like, you know, I was that person. So it was just something like I felt like that was, you know, my purpose in life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that. That's beautiful. And then to be able to tap into that so early.
Yeah.
And you got yourself out of the church. You kind of like saved yourself from furthering that brainwashing.
Programming.
Yeah.
Brainwashing. Yes, I did. Yeah.
So that's powerful. When you so after the 2 years.
Yeah.
From what I've learned and seen you talk about, you were like, this is no longer resonating with me. Mm-hmm. And you jumped into the music industry.
Yes.
As a manager.
Yes.
And everything. Because I remember you saying you played all the roles.
Every single role there was. Yes.
It just felt like what? It was exciting or it was intriguing? It was a challenge?
Yes, it was a challenge. Like, I'm one of those people, like, I need to be challenged. Like, I need to not necessarily be doing something, but being challenged, I feel like that's what helps me to grow, you know?
So you don't stray away from challenge.
No, I don't. I'm like head first, you know? Because I feel like there's always a solution to anything, you know? So I don't stray away at all. Bring it on.
Yeah. Wow. And you look, the way I'm looking at you, it's just like you're so kind of like soft.
Oh.
And then I'm like, but behind closed doors, like you get it done, because to jump in at that role
oh my gosh,
and then not necessarily having the experience, the industry is intense.
It really is. It was really tough, and like at that time, like I was his girlfriend, so it's like they didn't really respect. They probably don't still respect women today in the industry as they should. Sure. And so I really had to like prove myself, you know, and at one point I had to bring in like a male to, you know, play that role for me. But they eventually realized like, hey, Drika's the one that's still making decisions. She's still calling the shots, like, you know?
Yeah.
So
how old were you when this happened, when you said, okay, I'm doing this?
Oh gosh, 2006. So how old was I? Maybe 19 or 20.
Yeah.
Something like that.
And so, so it was exciting. And then you got in there and you saw that it was, you know, kind of bias towards the male.
Yes.
Towards the male view. And so was that, who helped you navigate that? Was it you in prayer, or what was it?
It was me. And I've learned recently that I'm very good with like manifesting things, like energetically rather than just like physically doing. Mm. And I did do my research. Like, I bought this book by Don Passman, All You Need to Know About the Music Business. And I ran across my notes a couple of weeks back where I took notes on like from the book about the industry and like your key players and about a little bit about everything, you know? Mm. So, but I really just like, I just navigated myself.
Like, it was just like an inner like knowing.
Inner knowing, yes. Yeah.
So when you say the difference between physically manifesting versus energetically manifesting, you're saying that it doesn't require like this 24 hours of racking your brain and just working, doing, that you can actually, I guess, just believe it enough?
Yes. Yes, yes. People don't know. I use the word love all the time because the love is the secret. Love is the key. Like, love is an emotion that's of like the highest vibration. Mm. So I don't know if, are you familiar with like this, The Secret?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So The Secret was, after that came out, they came out with Love, because love is the secret.
The secret.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And it's that vibration that you feel. Do you know how you feel when you feel love?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like having that feeling behind a vision is what brings it to life.
I totally get that, because when I think about the times when I felt so much love, you're so present.
So present.
You're like, you can't think of anything else. And there's no like opposing thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like you're zoned in.
Zoned all
almost
the way
in the sense of like when you're like making love.
Yes.
It's like when it's, you're like,
you're going into like a whole other thing that I'm like studying right now, because like the sexual energy, which is also our creative energy, that's what we use to not only make babies, but that's how we bring our ideas to life as well. So you're like going way.
That's a whole thing.
Yes.
Yeah, because I saw that. Are you getting
the sex and love certification? Yes. And that's a part of it. It's not all about do this position and da da da. It's really about like sexual healing and using our sexual creative energy to like manifest things.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So how did you, at that early age, I'm just like, how did you know all this stuff, girl?
I didn't know that I was doing it. To be honest with you, I had no clue.
Yeah. And so have you always just been a positive person?
Yes.
Okay. Optimistic.
Yeah. Very.
A dreamer.
A dreamer. That was me. But I'm also that person that gets shit done too.
Yeah. Are you a Virgo?
Yes.
Okay. I felt like you were a Virgo, but then I thought you were a Leo for a second.
No. Don't dare call
No?
Me. I'm just... Virgo.
Virgo. Yes. But yeah, the Virgo women get it done.
Yes, we do.
Oh, wow. So what is it about Virgo women you believe that...
We're grounded. We're earth signs. Like, we're the ones that, like, hold shit together, you know? Mm. So we're very detailed, organized, and yeah. So... And we always, we love, we know that there's always a solution. Like, we're going to find a solution.
You're solution driven.
Yes. Yes. We don't stay stuck like in
you
a
don't
problem.
Deal with all the obstacles as much as you do, as much as you focus on the solution.
Exactly.
And getting to the solution.
Yes.
And that's just natural, part of y'all's sign.
I would think so.
Yeah.
Because I have a few Virgos in my life and they kind of all operate on the same wavelength. And it's amazing.
Oh, okay. Yes. So, okay, tell me more about how long were you actually managing in the music, the day to day life? How many years was that?
Oh gosh, 17 years. So from 2006 to 2022, like the beginning of 2022.
Wow.
So that was like my life.
So day to day, what was that like? Was that early morning flights, calls, traveling?
That's flights, that's calls, that's emails, that's everything. Your life is literally consumed. Like, when you're in that industry, you're taking phone calls at 2, 3, 4 in the morning.
Yeah.
Somebody has an idea or need to set up studio last minute, or you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, it's a lot. Mm-hmm.
And was it fun? Was it fun the whole time?
You know what? It is fun because, I'm also a creator.
Okay.
I'm a builder. Like, I love bringing things to life. So it's like I was able at the same time to be creative. Like, there are really like no rules. You can pretty much do whatever you want to.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So it was fun, you know, but also that can get really stressful as well, you know.
The stress of just like not having that alone time or.
Oh, gosh. I haven't been alone in years.
Because you had children. At what point did you have your children?
Oh, gosh. It was some years in. I was like maybe 7 years
okay.
in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it was yeah, a little bit ways in. But once they came, like, they were on the road with us mm-hmm. in car seats.
I love that.
In my little kangaroo pouch.
I love that.
Yes.
So when you decided to leave school, because I left school too. I dropped out at my sophomore year.
Yeah, man.
It was just like, no.
Yeah, it's like, this is just not it.
No, yeah. And at that time, I was in the music industry as well. And so aww. I pursued it. And I didn't, from then, I kind of like left the guidance of my parents. They didn't want me to leave. They also didn't know how to guide me
in
where I was going. So I turned to like some of the people that I was signed to help me navigate. And that was very, very interesting. But for you, like, when you decided to, when you made that decision, what did your parents, your mom specifically, your dad,
gosh, they were totally against it. Like, I was literally cut off because I went from this, okay, if you go be a doctor, that is very safe, this very secure, to going and like, I mean, he wasn't a rapper when I met him. Like, that wasn't a thing. This was something that we were literally built from the ground up. You know, so it's like this big unknown, you know, and they're like, what is happening?
Were they mad at you?
Oh, hell yeah. Like I said, they cut me off. Like, I was cut off.
Meaning like, don't come home?
I was cut off. All of the above. I was, don't come home. Don't.
Dang.
Like, we're taking everything. Like, yes.
And so that was a crossroads for you.
That was a major crossroads. It was like when that happened, it was like, okay, well, there's no turning back now. Like, I'm going to have to figure this out, you know?
Yeah. And when you were speaking to Kevin, he knew that you obviously were cut off, right?
He knew, but he was like, I got you.
I got you.
Yeah.
Was that really reassuring?
No, it really was, because like at the end of the day, he's my best friend.
Yeah.
And he's super supportive. Like, we're both really supportive of one another. And he actually had to come and pick me up.
He did.
Yes.
Because it was just like, because
they like took my car and everything.
Wow.
Yes.
So were you kind of like spoiled?
So I grew up in like upper middle class. So like as soon as I turned 16, I had a car. You know what I'm saying? Like
it was, you had all the things.
Yeah. Like I had a very nice upbringing. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And so, and they probably thought that was going to change your mind once they were like, can't we're taking everything.
Yeah. I'm sure they did, because I don't like saying this, because my dad is amazing. I love him to death. Like, we have a great relationship now, and same with my mom, but it was like, I felt like they were trying to control me with like material stuff. Mm. And I'm like, I don't care about that stuff, you know? Ah. So I really do think that they thought that that would have like deterred me from doing it.
And it didn't.
No.
And it didn't.
No.
Yeah. I mean, clearly.
No.
And that's the inspiring thing, though. Yeah. That's the really inspiring thing, to just look at you and say, oh, wow. Like, you, because often people go into the industry to get the material things, to get the fame.
Yeah.
And you were just following your heart. You wanted to have fun.
Yes.
You wanted to be challenged. You wanted to live life.
Yes. That's really what it was all about for me. It wasn't even about all that. It was like, I literally left a nice life, you know what I'm saying, to start from scratch, you know. So
yeah, when you were saying that you brought in a male to help, like, you know, just, I guess, kind of be a placeholder for men who don't understand how to communicate with a woman.
Yes.
So at that point when you did that, Was it a chip to your ego in any way?
Of course it was, but it was like, okay, I had already understood that, like, okay, this is, I'm in the game, you know, mm-hmm. so I have to play the game. Okay. So if that's what you want, here you go, you know, but I'm still behind the scenes working. I'm still the one that's doing all the work, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
So.
And did you have to actually like split your like percentage with that person?
Yes. Yes, I had to pay this person. Yes,
yeah,
I did.
Yeah, but you basically took it on the chin, because you were like, you're looking at the bigger picture.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. How was it for you to, I guess, maintain some type of individuality or independence when your new career path at that time was kind of dedicated to helping someone else?
Right. And to be honest with you, I'm not sure I could say that I did maintain my independence, you know?
Yeah.
I thought I did, but like being the person and the space that I'm in now, I'm like, no, like I dedicated like my entire life to that, you know? Like there was no me like outside of that. Mm-hmm. Like, so that was my life. So I can't sit here and say,
you
know,
that
I made,
But just reflecting on it, now you're like, okay.
Yeah.
And was that a big part of your shift?
Yes, it was. Yeah. I say that like once I made the switch from that to doing like the wellness stuff, it was like a literal like identity crisis. It was like this person that I've been for almost 2 decades. Like I'm not that person anymore. Like I don't even identify with that person anymore.
Yeah.
You know?
Was there, so I guess approaching that 17 year mark, mm-hmm. was there anything that like happened, maybe like spiritually or in your life that was like, hold on, we need to check this, restructure. Yeah. Like, is anything that happened?
It was COVID.
COVID.
Like COVID was a real, like it was a blessing for me, mm-hmm. you know, because it really, and as it should have been, I'm not gonna say should have been, but as it was, I hope for a lot of people, you know, because it really, it made a lot of stuff come to the surface, you know? And in that, I actually had the time to focus on the wellness stuff, mm-hmm. because that's something that's always been, I've always been super passionate about it. But it gave me the opportunity to really like focus on that.
Cause everything slowed down.
Exactly. We weren't doing anything, you know, like people were doing streaming concerts on their laptops from their bedrooms or living rooms. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like there was no touring. There was none of that. Yeah.
Was there ever a question in your mind, or like in Kevin's mind that you're like, you're abandoning him? Did he feel abandoned?
Oh.
Did he? Because I remember in one interview you were like, I'm going, you coming?
Yeah.
And like, was there more of a discussion around that? Because I know as women, I don't know about Virgo women because y'all are beasts. But as women, we tend to like want to like nurture so much. Yes. We don't nurture ourselves as much, but we know how to nurture everything others around us. Mm-hmm. And I know for me in my life, a lot of times I've been like, When I choose myself, I feel like I'm not choosing someone else, and I feel bad.
Yes.
And I'm working on that. I'm getting a lot better, but yes. I think it's a real thing.
It is a real thing, because that was me for 17 years. Mm. Like, I did that for 17 years, and it was like, when I had that conversation with him, that was at the end of 2019 when I had like this download to move to our farm in Mississippi. And when I made it to the farm, it was like, I don't think I ever spoke on this, but I was dealing with crazy acne. I didn't know what was going on. I was a vegan, eating super clean. And when I met with my doctor, he was like, you're like stressed out. Like, stress is killing you. Like, this is stress on your face. Mm. And that was also just like another turning point. But it was during COVID when that happened. And that was like the switch for me, you know, and that's when I started really just like working on myself, you know, and really just letting go and really, really being selfish in a good way, though.
In a good way.
Yes.
And I don't think people understand truly stress.
Stress is a real killer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a real killer. I don't know if you're familiar, but Dr. Africa, he's
I've heard of
him. Yeah, Dr. Africa. He's similar in that same lane as Dr. Sabi, but I learned so much from him, and he talks about dire stress. Mm-hmm. And where that comes from is like dire digestive, and then I can't even remember the rest. Excretory system, but there's like four systems in your body that stress will shut down.
Uh-huh.
And that's when your body just starts to kind of die.
It does. That's why I said like it can really like stress can people die from stress.
Yeah. And I don't think that the medical field or they're not really connecting the dots. They're not connecting the dots for you. They're just saying, we don't know. And
exactly. But yeah. Stress is like the underlining cause of a lot of ailments in the body. Yeah.
Dang. And I believe that stress is directly related to the idea that we think caring for ourselves is selfish.
Exactly. Which I really, really had to get out of that. And it was rough for me too.
With children.
With children, a husband. It's a very difficult space to get out of. But once you're out of that, like, it's amazing, because when we pour into ourselves, we're able to give that much more to our loved ones. You know? And so that's like that's like the motivation behind it for me. Cause it's like, when I give to myself, I'm able to give more.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I said it in that little caption I put on today. I was like, I'm no longer interested in pouring into other people's cups. I'm going to fill mine up, and my overflow is going to nurture everything around me.
Yes.
And that's the motto for now.
I love it. But that is so true and factual. Like, that is something that I live by. So
Tell me, what was it though? Because you said that you got stressed and you went to the doctor. Mm-hmm. Was it just the time to reflect that allowed you to become comfortable and certain about your next move, like to be selfish?
Yeah. I mean, because the thing is like, in my mind, I'm not stressed, right? Yeah. This is in my mind. But doctor's like, no, you're fucking stressed out.
Wow.
You know? And I felt like I was doing everything that I could do to be at, you know, the healthiest that I thought that I was the healthiest I've ever been in my life and all these things. And that just wasn't the truth. Mm. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't true.
Yeah.
So that's what really, that was a major turning point for me. It's like, whoa, like I'm killing myself. You know what I'm saying?
So it was like a life or death.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I wasn't on my deathbed, but it was for me because I had never been in that state before. Like, my skin and all that. Like, yeah.
He was like, uh-uh, hold on.
Yeah, no, like,
now,
we got to get
now we
this
got the skin.
Exactly. Like, no, this is a problem. this is a problem.
But I mean, the universe knows. They're like, okay, we're gonna give her some acne because that's the only way she's gonna listen.
Exactly. That's our bodies do that. That's yeah. how it was showing up for me in the face. She was like, okay, you're not paying attention to this. We're gonna put it on your face. That's gonna get you to sit your ass down, right?
Because they knew that you were not going for that.
Exactly. So yeah, that was it.
So you're known for your natural beauty, your mm-hmm. natural aesthetic. And I love it. I'm here for it.
Thank you.
I admire it so much. What would you say your tips are to even, you know, becoming a woman, a mom, a CEO, and all those things, not feeling, I guess, pressured mm-hmm. to fit into the trends of now, which is like a beat face every day yeah. and like all the different things that supposedly make us more beautiful.
Yeah.
But you are like, I'm showing up fresh face. Yeah. I'm going to do a little here and there and we're just going to keep it moving. Like, how did you navigate that being so long?
To be honest with you, like, I feel more comfortable, like, literally just being in my skin. Like, mm-hmm. when I put on makeup and stuff, like, I don't feel like I'm myself. Like, I feel like I yeah. feel ugly with makeup on.
You. Yeah, yeah. When I put on makeup, I'm like,
who is this person?
Yeah.
That's how it really makes me feel. And I'm just not comfortable doing it. I'm more comfortable just in my skin as I am. And I've gotten to a point of like really knowing who I am and what I want, what I desire, what I like. And that's like, I'm standing on that, you know?
So. And have there been people along the way that have like side-eyed you or been like, girl, you better put on some. You're not gonna put on this or you're not gonna do that? Like,
yes, that has happened to me. I fell for it, but I'm like, nah.
Yeah.
Like, you got me that one time and that's
yeah.
it.
And yeah. then you like brought yourself back to
exactly. To I'm like, reality. No, I'm not doing it anymore. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. I love that. and then I'm assuming like with it's a more easeful life, like you being like managing everything that you do, like right now, wellness, mm-hmm. Love's Harvest, Mommy Farm.
Yeah.
What is your, I would say, your go-tos for keeping yourself centered to like play all those roles?
Oh gosh, so I have help.
Okay. Yes,
number one.
Help is great.
Having help, yes. But then outside of that, just really kind of making sure that I'm remaining like in my, like in top health, top shape. I do have a few different practices that mm-hmm. I do. Mm-hmm. So like I of course experience everything that every other human being experiences,
yeah.
but like I worked with a spiritual psychologist and I learned like all of these amazing tools just for like processing life, processing the things that we experience, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
And I will have to say that is like my main tool. Like I've learned how to, if you think back to like a toddler, right? Mm-hmm. And a toddler will lay out on the floor, kick, scream and holler for a minute straight. The next minute they're up running around like nothing ever happened, you know?
Yeah.
And so like I've pretty much I've relearned mm-hmm. that way of just processing life's experiences.
So you basically like push the energy out any way that you can.
Yes. And you can do that through like writing. I will write for like, I call it high vibe writing. Uh-huh. I write for 12 minutes. This is where I curse, scream, whatever, mm-hmm. 12 minutes. And then I burn that. And it actually like neutralizes that negative energy.
Wow.
Yeah.
It works for you.
Oh yes. Mm-hmm. It works for me.
Nice.
Yes.
So the high vibe writing and then you work out.
Working out. Yes. I also spend a lot of time like outside in nature, like yeah. on the farm, just okay. walking around barefoot, playing with the animals, like that is just really, really, mm. really like important to me, and it's very like grounding and fulfilling, mm. you know?
Yeah. Would you ever go back to like the city living?
No.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Like once you feel that feeling of like, ooh, I am at my highest vibration.
Yes, like you don't want to go back to that, and that's the space that I'm in. So yeah. it's like I'm building my forever home on the farm. Mm-hmm. Like I still travel a lot.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
I'm
yeah.
in
I see cities. You pop out.
Yes, you know, but I pop right back in on the farm because that's where I get to recharge. That's where I've literally have like transformed. So it's like that place is always going to have like a special place in my heart,
yeah,
you know?
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that. With, I would say like with you being in the spotlight for so much of your life, and now you're creating, you've created a whole new thing that focuses around your journey, your personal journey as a woman. How has it been navigating friendships, female friendships, people that want to be around you, like, you know, it's always like, oh, like, I want to be your friend, but then I really want to do business with you, or I really want to, your resources to spill on top of me. Like, has that been a thing?
To be honest with you, I don't even, like, I don't really have friends.
You don't have friends.
Yeah, like, it's strictly, like, I'm not going to say I don't have friends, but I really don't. Like, I spend a lot of time with my family. Mm-hmm. And then, like, the people that are working with me are my family and friends, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So
that's
it's
how it
not,
turns in.
Yeah.
So you don't, it's like, is it kind of just like no new friends type of energy?
I'm not saying that, but I'm saying that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I do meet like amazing people along the way, and then they get added into the family. And so that's how that goes. But I'm just not out here like, you know, oh girl,
let's link
go
up. Yeah. That's not really the vibe.
No.
So you, do you believe that has kind of protected you from some of the drama that comes with, I would say, female friendships?
Yeah. I mean, in a sense, yes. You know, because, yeah.
What?
No, I was going to say most definitely. But I will say, like, I did this 3-month course back in, I don't know, a few years back. And it was so great to be around a bunch of women that were like uplifting women. Mm. Like, it was so beautiful, and I had never experienced that before in my life. And you know, that's why you're asking me these questions.
Yeah.
Like, it's very difficult to find women supporting other women.
Yeah.
You know,
in
a genuine manner. Right.
In
and
a
it's
genuine
so
manner.
Needed. You
yeah.
know?
So what was this? This was a course?
Yes. It's called Ladder to Bliss.
Okay.
I did a master class with the lady who runs this course. Her name is Bibi. Uh-huh. It is so amazing.
Really?
It's amazing.
And so is it like a retreat kind of thing?
It is, but it's something that you do online.
Okay.
And it's basically you really just like reconnecting with yourself and like stepping into your power.
Yeah.
So it's amazing. Like, I feel like it's what sex ed should have been. It's what we should have been taught as little girls, like, to, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah
it's amazing.
Wow.
And like the sex and love certification that I'm working on, like, my intent is to come up with my own program like that, because it was literally like it was transformative.
So the sex and love, that is that to help? Is it to help relationships?
It can. Like, okay. So the funny part is supposed to be a sex, love, and relationship situation.
Uh-huh.
But for me, I feel like relationships are like, you know, one size does not fit all.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely not. No.
One size does not fit all. But I feel like once we really align like with our higher selves, once we change the way we relate to ourselves, the way we relate to other people changes, and that changes our relationships. You know, that's what I've learned from my own like personal experiences, and just from like helping out the people around me. So it's like, that's why I'm like, you know, a person to each its own when it comes to their relationships, but I can show you how to really like fall in love with yourself. You know?
I think people are often afraid to take that journey, because it does require digging in.
Ooh, yes.
And maybe sometimes like experiencing some of the pain.
Yes.
And also like the idea of like people, myself included, have not always liked the idea of feeling like, oh, so I can't have a partner, or I can't, we're not in a relationship. There's no love. Like, what am I doing? Like the idea of like being on a solo journey can be kind of abrupt.
Yeah.
Because we're taught from the very beginning, serve God.
Yes.
Be nice, be acceptable, be, you know, presentable.
Yes.
All these things that are like outward facing.
Yes.
And not like, love yourself. Make sure you like what you did.
Exactly. Yes, we are not taught that. And that's actually something that I make sure I teach my kids, because I don't want them growing up and having to do all the work that I've done.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So,
That's beautiful.
Yes.
Do they know how cool their mom is?
I don't know. They might. I don't know.
And so you homeschool.
Yes, they're homeschooled.
I love that. Yes. I don't have children right now, but I have two nephews, and I realized I had a hard lesson to learn that, like, those are not your children.
Oh, yeah.
They are not your children. Yes. And as much as you love them, like, they're your own, they have a mommy and a daddy who, you know, those are their guides.
Yes.
And, but I wanted them to be homeschooled. Oh. And, I mean, obviously it's like, girl, they're not your children. Get over it. Have your own children if you want to make those kind of calls. But right. they're 3-year-old and 7-year-old, and so the 7-year-old is like super smart. He's like a scientist. He wants to just do it all, and he loves school, right? So he's in a special school, but he's like obsessed. And but I always said that when I do have children, like, you know, they talk about when they're homeschooled, oh, they don't interact, and it's like, well, there's going to have so many opportunities to interact outside of the learning experience or like whatever, you know? So like, what is like it like for you homeschooling?
So my kids, I do have someone that comes in and like actually does the work with them.
Yeah.
Cause I don't have the time for, but, she's amazing and they love her, but they do socialize. Like my kids, they do karate, they do sports, they go on play dates. They, you know what I'm saying? So they interact with kids all the time, you know, so that's not, people do say that a lot. They're like, oh, your kids don't socialize. And I'm like, no, my kids socialize.
And then also like, everyone's not meant to, I don't need to have my kids experience all these people. Everybody ain't
right. Exactly. That part.
So you're just going to throw me out there?
Yes. So,
okay. I get that. But so they are active and living their best life.
Oh, yes, they are. Yes. They're very happy. Happy little beings.
I kind of wanted to touch on like the part that you mentioned about an identity crisis.
Mm-hmm.
And the crisis sounds intense. Like, what was crisis-y about it?
Like literally identifying as this person and then not being that anymore. Like I literally put everything into like that career, the management career. Like that was my life. I did not have anything outside of that.
Mm-hmm.
Like I had absolutely nothing. When I say
nothing going on
outside of that, you know?
Yeah.
So that was, I mean, that was a crisis for me.
Did it start to feel like maybe just like a little bit of like what people would often call depression? Like, were you ever feeling like you wake up some days and be like, what am I doing? Who am I? Where am I? I feel sad.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest with you, I don't even like using the word depression.
Yeah,
because
I know.
It's like, and not to say that it's a bad thing, but I feel like because of all the work that I do, like with the different, just like, I guess you call it, people call it shadow work now.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to use the term shadow work. I do a lot of different forms of shadow work to combat that, you know?
Yeah.
Because for me, like depression is really just like stuck energy in the body. Mm-hmm. Like you're just weighed down.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Well, that's just what I found.
But
no, it wasn't that. It was like me really stepping into this new role that was foreign to me.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
Like it, I mean, just imagine
to figure out how to be.
Exactly. Literally, you know, and that was for me, like, you know, cause that was my, like, I did this.
It's like,
I'm stepping away from that to start something totally new, you know?
Did you have a lot? So I get it. I get what you're saying. So maybe your identity was tied to that word.
Exactly. Yes.
And so did you have moments where you would be like, well, is anyone going to care what I'm doing now? Is this as important as what people, you know, because you get so much praise and admiration for doing one thing,
mm-hmm.
and then it's like you switch over and like people are like, what?
Right. For me, like what I'm doing now is crazy because it was really just me on my own journey, doing my own self-discovery, self-exploration, and it came to me that I needed to share that, you know?
Yeah.
And so, of course, I was kind of a little bit like, do people even want to like hear about this? Do you want to see about this? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But something came over me and it felt like this was like my purpose in life to do this, to share this, you know, because I feel like a lot of the knowledge is knowledge that was stripped away from us, stripped away from our parents, stripped away from our grandparents.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and this is me bringing it back, you know?
So that's like a real generational
Like we're breaking healing, cycles over here.
You're breaking cycles. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. And you're breaking it in the form of living differently.
Exactly. Because the way we change the past is by what we do now and in the future. Like, that's how we change the past.
Yeah. And not just talking about it.
And not just talking about actual, like, actions. Taking action.
Yeah, taking action.
Yes.
So you've definitely been taking action. I love it. Tell me about Love's Harvest.
Love's Harvest. So Love's Harvest is my baby. It's my passion project. And it's a cannabis dispensary.
Okay,
it's my first solely owned operated dispensary. It's by me. I'm the sole owner operator.
Congratulations. Can we Thank get some you. Claps? I was going to say post. Okay, never mind.
And I'm opening up on 420 in Mississippi.
Yes.
And for me, it's where I get to share like my love of just not just cannabis, but just plant medicine in general.
Yeah.
And like helping people to realize the power that they have within themselves with the support of like plant medicine.
Yeah.
So it's like, that's my intent with this.
That's crazy. Yes. So there will be more than just cannabis, are you saying?
Eventually, yes. Like I can't legally have more than just cannabis in there, but you know, like medicinal mushrooms.
Yeah.
So yeah, like and then all sorts of other different herbs and plants, like just simple things like elderberry and you know,
yeah,
things like that. Yeah.
Did it feel, because I knew, like I guess this was several years ago when they started to legalize it, and everyone was, not everyone, but the people that knew were like rushing to the scene to be a part. And from what I heard, some of my friends were saying, yeah, they're not making it easy for Black people. And then I'm assuming, okay, if they didn't make it easy for Black people, they definitely didn't make it easier for a Black woman. Did you experience that, or did you just, you manifested it energetically before you walked in? You're like, yeah, I'm getting it.
I swear I did.
You did.
But yes, they did not make it easy. I mean, it's not easy at all. First of all, you're paying thousands of dollars for just a piece of paper to say that you can legally do business. You know, that doesn't account for all the business, the actual business expenses. Yeah.
Yeah.
So yes, they did make it difficult. But for me, it's like, I went in knowing like, oh no, I had the vision. I'm putting the love behind the vision. Like, this is going to happen.
Yeah.
And yes. So I didn't hit too many roadblocks.
Okay.
I mean, it has been a struggle. Well, I'm not gonna say a struggle, but a challenge.
A challenge.
Because I've been doing like construction. Like, I've been renovating a historical building from like the 1800s.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Whoa.
Yes.
Like, what made you go that route?
Oh my gosh. Well, it wasn't my first choice. So you can't have it like within a certain distance of like churches, daycares and things like that. And those things are like on every single block.
In Mississippi.
Yes. So like my first and second choice wasn't available. And then I just ended up with this building that's absolutely amazing.
I feel like it's amazing.
It's going to be even more amazing. I don't think there's any dispensary like it. And I'm not just saying that.
So are you going to have like any type of like ID or certification to get in there?
Yeah.
Like to purchase?
Yes. So for now, like Mississippi has like a really cool setup to where we're only medicinal, like right now, like medical, you have to have a medical card, but we can sell topicals to you if you're 21 and older.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of cool. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm excited.
Yeah.
I want to come down there. I'm going to New Orleans for the first time in July.
What?
Yeah. Never been.
Where's home for you?
So home is Atlanta.
Okay.
But
I mean, like, where were you born and raised?
I was born in Nashville, but I wasn't raised there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I wasn't raised anywhere because I moved around so much until after high school when I came here.
Okay.
So everywhere was like 2-3 years.
Oh.
So I lived in, I was born in Nashville. Then we moved to Connecticut.
Oh, wow.
Then we moved to Macon, Georgia.
Wow.
Columbus, Georgia.
Wow.
Huntsville, Alabama.
Wow.
Then I moved here.
Wow.
And I used to live in California. My mom's side of the family is from California, but her mother and father are from Louisiana.
I was just gonna say
from Shreveport,
Louisiana, especially Shreveport, has so many like a lot of connections, like people in California. Like I've ran into a lot of people that have said the exact same thing that you said.
Really?
That they're from Shreveport, Louisiana.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. My mom used to go to New Orleans all the time growing up. And because of religion, I was like, you shouldn't go there. Oh my God. And so I'm super excited to go.
It's fun.
And so it's not far from Mississippi, is it?
No, like it's right above. So I am like an hour, 10 minutes north of New Orleans.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I got to stop by.
Really close.
Because we're actually going down there as a team. We're taking a sprinter for like, what is it called? Essence Fest?
Essence Fest.
Yeah. So we might have to swing by.
That is gonna be awesome.
Because you'll
yes.
be open, right?
I will be open.
Yeah.
Yes, for sure.
Yeah. Okay. I'm excited.
That is
about
so cool.
Because you spoke about having help. And I'm assuming that's help with all your businesses.
Oh, yes.
Day to day, family life, all that stuff.
Yes.
I'm a true believer of like delegating.
Yes.
I'm like, I don't like to be overwhelmed and stressed. I like to like focus on what I'm good at. And what typically I'm like, have the vision and then put people in place to help with that.
Yes.
What is that like for you on the farm?
Oh, so I have, like I said, help.
Yeah.
I have right now, I probably have like four, like we call them farm hands to like handle all, well, really to just like maintain everything on the farm. And then my teacher, my kids have their teacher.
They're your teachers.
Yes. And then I also have like a nanny that helps as well.
Okay, nice.
Because we travel a lot.
Yeah.
And the kids travel as well. And then like I have like my team for my Drinka Wellness and also like Love's Harvest. So
yeah.
I have my people.
Yeah. Drinka Wellness. I love all of the content you create for.
Oh.
I just be like, oh.
Thank you.
You know, you're like a mixture of just, for me, I'm thinking like when I first started getting into like holistic living and plant-based and all that, I always, in spirituality, I kind of felt like it was all about like the head wraps and the, and the, you know, linen garments and things like that. And then I kind of got lost because I'm like, that's not me. Like, like I don't see, how do I do it? Like, I don't like it. And then you, for me, I'm like, okay.
Yes. Like,
I'm like,
right.
She's over here, but she is still like, she still
very
is very much,
much
so 2024 in this moment.
Yes.
Still likes the things. Still.
Yes. All the things. So I said that I'm having like I've had my full circle moment. So I did like really, really go like deep into that. And I still have like my linen dresses. I love my linen dresses. Like I still wear those, take pictures in those.
Yeah.
Yes. But I'm like, I've incorporated, that was me trying to like block out like my past, you know, and not that it was bad, but it was like, no, I'm on this spiritual journey right now. I'm way up here and da, 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 but it was like, no, like all of these, like, all of these versions of me are me, like, you know, and that's kind of like what I'm giving now.
Yeah. How did you get to that point though? Like
it takes some time.
Yeah. It takes some time.
It takes time. Yeah.
And was it like, it was just a constant, just like reflection.
Exactly. Cause like, when I tell you I did like work, I did a lot of work on myself.
The work that people don't see.
Yeah. Like, I mean, and it's not, I'm not gonna say it's not for sharing with the world, but you're not gonna have a camera on you while you're meditating.
Yeah.
Or while, you know what
exactly.
I'm saying? Like who, if you're doing that, unless you're like teaching a class or something or just trying to share a message, like why would you be doing that?
Right.
But yeah, it's just a lot of deep diving. And like I feel like now the space that I'm in, I'm like, yeah, there you go, girl. Yeah. That's you right there.
That's all the pieces of
all
you.
All the pieces, all the different versions. It's like I'll go from listening to my I have this song by Beautiful Chorus. I love this song. It's called Infinite Universe. And it's like love will last forever in this infinite universe. Like I'll go from listening to something like that to listening to like Sexy Red. And
okay.
Just, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But it's like,
you
I
know.
Can do, I know who I am. You know what I'm saying? I can do all of those things. I enjoy all of those things, you know?
Yeah.
And it's okay.
And it's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a big lesson for many of us to learn, to accept and acknowledge all that we are.
All that we are, like every single version of ourselves. Mm-hmm. Like I might want to wear heels one day, might want to have on freaking Air Jordan ones one, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. The next, like, it's okay. Like the, yeah. I enjoy all these things.
And that's, like you said, it's a journey, and it takes time to get to the place where you are comfortable.
Yes.
Showing up as the different versions of yourself, yeah, in different places.
Yes.
Because people, and I know, you know, being in the spotlight, people are ready,
oh, yeah,
to have an opinion.
Ready.
They're ready to say, oh, she's supposed to be natural. Exactly. And she's over here. It's like,
I could care less.
That's so good.
Because yeah, it's like, what, your opinions are like so irrelevant to me. Yeah. Like they're not. Yeah.
Have you always been like that though? Been able to be like, I don't care what you think.
No, I have not. But recently, like that's the space that I'm in now. Like I honestly learned that so much is irrelevant. Like there are so many things are irrelevant in life, you know?
Yeah. back to the natural beauty, like, mm-hmm, you were speaking about just like not feeling like yourself when you were doing all this, yes, extra stuff. Is there, do you look at it as also like a health and longevity journey as well as to,
oh, yes,
to have that clean beauty, or I would call it?
Oh yes, for sure. Because I eat clean. What I put on my body is clean. Like I'm really, really, really deep off into that. And I didn't realize how deep I was into it until I went to like this expo. It's supposed to be like a natural foods expo, mm-hmm, but I could barely eat anything that was at this natural food expo.
Was it like a lot of processed stuff?
I mean, yes, but there was a lot of sugar and a lot, mm-hmm, of just like things that like I don't consume on the daily. And yeah, like my skin actually broke out after I left, and I was like, wow, Driga, like you really do eat clean.
Yeah, yeah. Once you go that direction, you try to go back, your body's gonna,
yeah,
be like,
what,
oh,
is going on?
Yeah.
But yeah, like I don't know how I got to this point, but yes, I'm like, I eat super, super,
yeah,
clean. Yeah.
And so you advocate for that.
I do because I feel better. Like I feel good, you,
yeah,
know? And that's what's like really important, you
do
know?
Do you have people having such a large following, mm-hmm, do you have women that ask you, I'm sure they ask you, like, how do you stay fit, how do you stay with that skin and all,
oh,
that,
yeah,
kind of thing, and when you give them the tea, do they, are they ready for it, are they ready to,
they're
hear
like
it?
I don't know if I'm like, you got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, and like my main thing is knowing your body. Like, so I'll get blood work done. Because, like, our bodies are constantly changing. Like, every, yeah, 7 years, like, every cell in our body is new. Like, we have a new body every 7 years. Like, this is scientifically proven, you know?
Yeah.
So, like, I get blood tests to check for, like, food allergens and just to check, like, my different, like, hormone levels and all these things. Mm. And so when I get those results back from the food allergen test,
yeah,
I immediately remove those things from my diet. But I'm also like so in tune with myself to where if I eat something, like I'm noticing what is feeling different in my body, and,
yeah,
I'm like, okay, I should not be eating that,
yeah,
anymore, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm just really, really in tune with myself and connected and,
yeah,
really mindful. So
that's a huge thing that I,
yeah,
want all women, I'm speaking to,
seriously,
us all, start taking the time to get to know yourself.
Yes.
We have to. This is no longer the age where we're just caring for others.
Mm-mm. No, it's not.
It's just over.
No.
You got to get it. You got to get it right.
Yes.
Even with women who are mothers, mm-hmm, I experienced this secondhand because of,
yeah,
a good friend of mine who was sacrificing so much for her child in the sense of working 3 jobs because she wanted to make sure that her daughter had everything, had, mm-hmm, opportunities. In the meantime, she's totally neglecting her health,
yeah,
her appearance, her social life, and all that stuff. And one time her daughter said in front of me, she was like, I don't want to be like my mom. And it crushed me.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, your daughter is watching you.
Right.
She's not, you know, necessarily absorbing as much of like the material things.
Right.
But she's watching how you are not really taking care of yourself.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so I feel like it's like, wake up and realize what the new generation is really absorbing.
Oh yes.
Versus what
they pay attention to, everything, to the things that we don't even think they're paying attention to. That's why it's so important for us to really, like, we have to do through our actions. Like, we can talk all day long, but they're watching what we're doing. They're mm-hmm. watching our behavior. They're mm-hmm. watching how we, you know what I'm saying, interact with people and ourselves. So that's super important. But yes, we definitely have to, pour into ourselves first. Mm-hmm. Just like they tell you on the airplane, put your oxygen mask on first. You know, like, please.
And that's a bar, because it's like, that's what they tell you to do.
Exactly.
It's like
you're not helping anybody by trying to help this person next to you first.
Yeah.
Like, you know,
I think so. that's such a good point.
Yeah.
So just tell me what's all a part of Drika Wellness.
So I have the skincare, of course, and those are like formulas that I literally have worked on for years. And they're all custom, like, and I use it day and night myself. Like, so everything that I share with through Drika is things that I use myself. So I have the skincare, and then I have like wellness tinctures to boost your immunity. I also have like Open for Love, which is like something that you can take to just really relax and like open yourself to just like receive. Chlorophyll for detoxing the body. But yeah, like that is like my platform for being able to like share the tools that I've gained along my journey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And these are like a little, is there like a chemist lab that?
Mm-hmm. I do work with, someone to create it, because I'm not that skilled. Yeah. And for the most part, like everything is plant-based.
That's
you
so
know?
Cool.
Yeah.
Do you think that either of your children are going to like take over the business at any point in time?
That would be my hope, you know, like that's why I'm doing this, you know?
Yeah.
So that would be my hope. For sure.
Do they seem interested?
My daughter is a little bit. My son, he's more so into like gaming and like engineering, things like that. But my daughter, she's also into like baking and things. So, you know, if they don't, like, it's okay.
Yeah, it's
but
okay.
Yeah, like yeah. I would love for them to, you know,
to take that on.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's so good. I love that you are guiding them, but not controlling.
Oh yeah. No.
Yeah.
Cause whatever their passion is, like that's what they're going to be successful in, you know?
Yeah. We talk about that as even in team building, it's like we assign tasks to people and then we just kind of have to watch and see, okay, actually, what are they good at? Let's let them do that every day, all day.
That is so important. And I feel like that's something that I'm actually good at. Like all my people around me, like they're doing what they are great at doing. And that's how you know.
Because everyone feels good about what they're doing.
Exactly.
Because it's something that they love to do. Everyone is like 10 out of 10 because it's their specialty.
Yes.
Yeah. That's the vibe. That's definitely the vibe.
Yeah.
So.
Yes.
You, birth doula.
Yes.
You're certified.
Yes. I am a certified birth doula.
You're such a renaissance.
Yes.
I'm just like, okay, so that's beautiful.
Yes.
And so the doula is not the same as like a midwife.
No, it's
okay,
not.
Okay, tell me about what a doula is.
Yeah, so the birth doula, like I'm there to support the woman. Like I'm there to help her to cope with the pain that she's experiencing. I'm there to make sure that she's comfortable. So I'm like giving massages, rubbing her feet, and just really just making sure that she's comfortable the entire time and that she's actually like, you know, and that she feels confident in what she's doing, you know? And I'm also a hypnobirthing childbirth educator.
What is
that? So that's really where I teach the women about what's happening with their bodies when they're giving birth. So that alone, like, removes the fear that so many women have going into childbirth, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, fear is what causes the tension, is what causes the pain.
Mm.
So it's like, we basically get to the bottom of, you know, like the fear that they have surrounding childbirth. We kick it out the window and, you know, and prepare these women to really just allow their bodies to do what they're made to do.
That's so beautiful. I want like everyone to get that certification, because what I feel like is happening is there's so much fear. There's so, so much death that's happening.
Yes.
And from what I believe and what I've learned is that we started doing it wrong the last 100 years.
Yep.
When, you know, the hospitals yep. came in.
Yep.
It's like doing it so wrong.
Yep. That was the problem. Like, we should have never gone to the hospitals. And the reason why the women died or the women are dying from birth, they're not actually dying from giving birth. They're dying from these interventions that are happening to them while they're in the hospital. Mm. It's not the birth.
It's not the birth. It's the birth is the most natural part, right?
Exactly. Like, our bodies are designed to do that. It's what's happening to them. It's all these interventions that are happening. Like, that's, and I actually experienced this firsthand with two of my certification clients. And I was like, whoa. And it was a major wake up call for me. And it's like, I would love to, it's my intent to do more in that space, but I have so much going on right now.
Yeah.
But like, I definitely have to do something more with that just to like shed light, really,
yes,
you know,
absolutely.
And to educate our women. So
absolutely.
Yeah.
I get teared up when I hear about just like,
oh my
gosh, hospital. Honestly, I mean, I ain't with it.
Yeah, I'm not either.
I'm really not, because it's just like, how many times does it have to happen for you to say, I'm gonna do what my great grandma did?
Right. That's where I'm at. That is the space that I'm in, because it's like, they've been doing this since the beginning of time.
Yeah.
Like, why did we change it? You
why
know?
Why did we change it? Yeah. That's the whole colonization thing that happened.
Yes.
But we're headed back in the right direction.
We are.
Yes. And thank you for, you know, putting yourself in a space to be a person to lead us into that.
Yes.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Thank you.
No, truly, truly. Yeah. Okay, so let's switch gears just really quickly. I want to get your insight on just to help women who are out there navigating the music industry. There's a lot of women in the music industry in a lot of different positions.
Mm-hmm.
And I already know that it's a struggle, and I often feel like the women are just they're just biting the bullet and they're just going for it, knowing that there is a lot of messed up
stuff
happening. What advice would you give to women who are in that space, who love music?
Yeah.
Maybe something like yourself, who are passionate about an artist or something like that.
Yeah.
What advice would you give them?
Oh my gosh. Just like, trust in yourself, believe in yourself. Mm-hmm. Like, you're in this position for a reason. You know what I'm saying? Just trust in yourself, trust in the process, and like, put your blinders on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, cut out all the outside noise. Like, you're here for a reason, you know, and just really just stand on that and go for it, you know, because when you walk into those offices, there's nothing but women in there sitting behind desk.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's what it is. Yeah. That I'm giving y'all the visual, okay? That's what
doing
it
all
is.
The, doing a lot of the legwork.
That's what it is, yes. Mm-hmm. And just build those relationships with those women. You know what I'm, that's what I did.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I'm still friends with a lot of the women that I started off with years ago, and they're like in freaking vice president, executive, like top positions now. You know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's so amazing. But it's like, there's a lot of women in the industry, you know?
Yeah. So you're basically just like, keep your blinders on. Remember why you're here and ignore the noise.
Exactly. Because if you listen to all of that, you're more than likely going to fail.
Yeah.
Like, just plain
and simple.
It is. That's all it is, you know, because I wasn't exactly like, I wasn't praised in the beginning, but I was like, whatever. Like, I know what I'm doing. Like, you know?
Yeah.
So
it held a little bit of a delusion to push through.
Yep.
What about, since you were successful in that space and then now you've become successful in this new space, what advice would you give to women who feel that transition coming, that they need it, that they want it, but are maybe scared?
Yes, I was afraid, you know.
So fear is gonna be there.
Fear is real. Fear is real, but you have to, the only reason why I'm where I'm at today is because I always trust in myself. Like, that is the biggest thing. Like, you cannot look to people for outside validation, because that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because just as quick as they build you up, that's as quick as they could tear you down. You know what I'm saying? Or and feed you a bunch of non-truths or shit that doesn't even apply to you.
Yeah, their experience.
Exactly. Or someone else's experience. It's like, okay, I understand that was your experience, but, you know, if I do run into that, like, I will find a solution for it.
Yeah.
Remember, there's always a solution.
There's always a
solution. Always a solution.
Okay. I love that. Yeah. That's powerful. Before we close, I have these beautiful affirmation cards.
Okay.
Reflect and Affirm by Rochelle Sine. Cards to nurture yourself and awaken your inner light.
Ooh.
Yes, yes, yes. So I want you to pick one.
Okay.
And then we'll just answer it.
Oh.
So, yeah, I think you're looking from this side. It's going to ask you a question, so you can pick whichever.
Okay. Okay.
And if you hate it, then you can go to pick another one.
Oh, no, it's okay. Because I believe in myself.
Okay.
So whatever I pull
is meant.
Exactly. And it fully applies. Ha! This is what we've been talking about. Okay.
Oh, really?
It says, what is a challenge that you have overcome that has made you stronger? I'm like, that's what our kind of like whole conversation was about today.
Yes, yes.
And then it says, this is the affirmation is, I am resilient and strong, capable of overcoming any challenge. And again, that's like what I just mentioned. Like, there's always a solution. Mm-hmm. Always. And then, like, the challenges are just opportunities for growth.
Yeah.
Like, don't look at it as a road. Well, you can look at it as a roadblock, but there's always a detour.
There's always a detour.
There's always a detour, you know?
And you believe that. For people, because you have to build your mind up to a place where you trust yourself.
Yes.
And for someone, many people come from environments where they are talked down on, where they are limited with people who have limiting beliefs.
Yeah.
So to even get to that point to say, I got the solution. What would you say? What would you say to help someone build themselves up to that point?
That comes with a lot of like practices with the shadow work, doing the writing and getting to the root of why you're feeling a certain way, you know, and flipping your perspective on those stories. Because I mean, even myself, like I grew up always feeling like I was never enough. Like I wasn't good enough. And I literally just kind of like worked through that over the past couple of years, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, we all have these little traumas that we've experienced and, ways of being and thinking that we've carried on from our childhood. And it's just like, once you recognize that, don't run from it. Like, really get to the root of it and put it to rest.
Put it to rest.
Yes.
Yes, amen.
Put that story to rest.
Okay. Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm so happy that I'm still like.
No, likewise. This has been amazing.
Thank you. I'm so glad that you came. I want you to look here in this camera, and I just want you to tell people where they can find you, all that you have going on. Right there. Okay.
Hey guys, it's Dreka Gates, and you can find me on Instagram at Dreka Gates, on YouTube at Dreka Gates TV, Twitter at Dreka Gates, and I think TikTok at Dreka Gates, and also at Dreka.com. So just check me out. I promise you won't be disappointed.
Yes.